Okay, so hello everyone. So I'm Anna Korba. I will present some recent work on Wasserstein gradient flows for machine learning. First, thank you very much for the invitation to the workshop. So I will try to present recent works with a bunch of collaborators from a bit everywhere, France, UK, and Saudi Arabia. So Adil Salim, Julia Louise, Arthur Gretton, Michael Orbel, Pierre-Cyril Aubin-Frankowski, Shimon Majewski, and Pierre Ablan. So the plan of the talk is as follows. I will present first the introduction and motivation for this for the study of Wasserstein gradient flows for machine learning. I will then give some background on the Wasserstein gradient flows, and I will present more deeply two applications, two motivations for this problem, and then I will present a bunch of recent results. And please do not hesitate to interrupt at any point if some notations are not clear or if you have questions. So the problem we are interested in is the following. We want to transport an initial probability distribution, that I call mu zero, on RD to some target probability distribution that I call pi on RD as well. So if you assume that the target distribution pi is, for instance, living in P2 of RD, so the set of probability distributions with bounded second moment, you can see this problem as an optimization problem over this space, P2, where you minimize some dissimilarity functional D that measures the dissimilarity between some distribution mu and your target distribution pi. So you can see this dissimilarity as a loss that you are optimizing on this space. And Wasserstein gradient flows find continuous paths of distributions on P2 if you equip this space with the Wasserstein 2 geometry, continuous paths that decrease this loss. So if you pick a specific time or space discretization of a Wasserstein gradient flow for the loss functional D, this results in an algorithm that can hopefully decrease or at least minimize the loss of interest. And actually, many problems in machine learning can be formulated this way, as minimizing some dissimilarity. So sorry, this should be a G. Some dissimilarity between probability distributions. For instance, in sampling, a distribution of interest is the posterior distribution of parameters in Bayesian inference. The second problem that I will present is the case of optimizing large neural networks, where in this case, the distribution of interest pi can be the optimal distribution over parameters of big neural network. But there are actually many other problems, for instance, generative modeling, computing the barycenter of distributions that you can find in the ML machine learning literature. And this point of view is interesting because you can design new schemes for approximating your target distribution pi, or you can study existing schemes as discretizations of Wasserstein gradient flows. So let me introduce the theory of Wasserstein gradient flows. So we work on the Wasserstein space, which is the set P2 of RD, so the space of probability distributions on RD with finite second moments. And we equip this space with the Wasserstein 2 distance from optimal transport. That is written as follows. So the Wasserstein 2 distance squared between two distributions mu and nu is the infimum over couplings between mu and nu, so joint distributions with marginal mu and nu, of the square Euclidean cost. Okay, and let me recall some definitions associated to this framework. I will need the definition of a push-forward measure. So if you pick a distribution mu in P2 and a measurable map T from RD to RD, the push-forward measure denoted P push-forward mu is the image measure. So if you have a measurable set B, T push-forward mu of B is mu of T minus 1 of B, or you can see this as if you have x distributed as mu, then t applied to x is distributed as t pushed from mu. And I will also need the notion of optimal transport maps to give more insights on the geometry behind the Wasserstein-Gradient flows. But there is a famous theorem in this literature called Brenius theorem that says that if you pick two distributions mu and nu in P2 and you take mu, which is absolutely continuous with respect to the Lebesgue measure, then you can find a unique optimal transport map that will push mu onto nu. That is also the gradient of a convex function. And this map realizes the Wasserstein 2 distance that I defined just before. It realizes the Wasserstein 2 distance as the L2 norm of the identity minus this optimal transport map. And I recall that the space L2 of mu is the space of functions f which are squared integrable with respect to mu. So why am I presenting this? It's because this gives some insights on what the Wasserstein 2 geodesics may look like. So for instance, if you have your two distributions mu and nu, the Wasserstein 2 geodesic in this case, if you have an optimal transport map, can be written as a mixture of maps that will push mu, and this mixture is 1 minus t, where t is between 0 and 1, times identity plus small t times the optimal transport map. So this is a horizontal displacement, horizontal displacement as on the right image, which is very different from vertical displacement as you would have in a mixture between the two distributions. So think of the geometry this way. I also need to define to present the concept of continuity equations. So a continuity equation will describe how a family of a distribution evolves. So if you fix a horizon of time big T, and you consider a family mu indexed by some time between 0 and big T, that maps at each time t some distribution mu t, it is said to satisfy a continuity equation if there exists a family of vector fields at each time that belongs to L2 of mu t, and such that distributionally, the following equation holds. So the time derivative of mu t plus the divergence of mu t times vt is equal to 0. So this equation holds in the sense of distribution, and it describes how the density mu t of particles xt in RD evolve when these particles are driven by a vector field vt. So if your particles obey the following ODE, they are pushed by the vector field vt, then their distribution mu t satisfies the continuity equation. And there is a whole Riemannian interpretation in this setting. You can think of L2 as it contains actually the tangent space of P2, the space of probability distributions as mu t. And Wasserstein gradient flows, so the continuous path that I'm interested in that decrease some loss of interest, they take actually the form of continuity equations. So let me show you why. So recall that we are interested in minimizing some functional d that takes as input a probability distribution and outputs some positive array. Sorry, it should be R plus. So the differential of g evaluated at some distribution mu is a function that I denote this way. So it's also called the first variation. It's defined this way. So if you perturb g by some measure mu prime minus mu, then the differential is given in this integral on the right. Okay, so if you take the first variation of the differential of g evaluated at mu, this is a function. But now, the Wasserstein gradient flow will rely on an object which is the Wasserstein gradient, which is slightly different from the first variation. I will explain why. So a family of distribution mu indexed by time, as before, satisfies a Wasserstein gradient flows of the functional G if distributionally the following equation holds. So it's a continuity equation where the vector field is minus, so I call this gradient, Wasserstein gradient of G, but what is this object? It's the gradient of the first variation, okay? So you take your function, let me recap. You take your functional G of interest, you can compute its first variation or its differential, this is a function, and then you take the gradient, and this, in rough terms, give you the Wasserstein gradient. Okay, and this Wasserstein gradient belongs to L2 of mu, to, once again in broad terms, the tangent space of the space of probability distributions at mu. Okay, so this equation describes a continuous path of distribution that decreases your loss G. And in particular, if your functional G is a free energy, which is a classical kind of functionals in optimal transport, you can write more explicitly its Wasserstein gradient flow. So for instance, a free energy writes as follows. So G can be the sum of three terms. The first one is referred to as internal energy. The second one as a potential energy. And the third one as an interaction energy. So the first one is a function of the density mu only. The second one is the integral of some potential V with respect to mu. And the third one is the integral of an interaction term W integrated with respect to mu two times. So in this case, if you apply the formula that we've seen before, which is that the gradient, the Wasserstein gradient of G is the gradient of the first variation, you can write the continuity equation. And a very famous case is the case where the internal energy is the negative entropy. So in this case, you have here the integral of log mu d mu, where mu is the density. Then equation one corresponds to the equation of ruling the density of particles xt, which are driven by the following equation. So here, the particles are driven by the vector field gradient V that will push the particles to the region where the potential energy is high. There is an interaction energy term, so the particles interact between themselves. And here, in the case of the negative entropy, we have a stochastic term, which is the Brownian motion. Okay, so think of this as particles. And all right, so we have the previous evolution for the particles, but if you want to simulate it in practice, you need first to choose the space and time discretization. So we'll first talk about the space discretization. We've seen that, the evolution of the particles, xt, depend on the distribution of the particles. So in this case, it is common to introduce interacting particle system, which what it does is that you replace the distribution mu t of the particle that is unknown at each time by the empirical measure of the system of capital N interacting particles. So you start from capital N particles distributed as the initial probability distribution that you chose. And for each particle j, between 1 and capital N, your number of particles, they evolve according to the following equation, where the distribution of the particles has been replaced by here the empirical distribution of the interacting particles. Okay, so this is regarding the space discretization. And now, if you need to discretize the previous equation in time, you have several choices. So let me come back at the level of probability distributions. A first choice is to discretize in an explicit way, so it's called the forward discretization, the Wasserstein gradient flow of your functional G. In this case, you can implement a kind of gradient descent where you push the previous distribution at time n by the map identity minus gamma, where gamma is some step size, times the gradient of your functional g at mu n. Okay, so you can see this as a kind of Riemannian gradient descent on the space of probability distributions. So this corresponds in RD to applying the following update on your particles. So if your particle at time n is distributed as mu n, you simply update the particles as follows. You push them through identity minus gamma, the gradient of g at mu n, applied to xn. So this is one discretization which is explicit. A second discretization which is possible is an implicit discretization in time. And in this case, so this is the analog of a proximal scheme in the Wasserstein space. In this case, mu n plus 1 is defined to be the JKO of the functional g at mu n. What it does is minimizing movement scheme. So at time n plus 1, you choose the distribution that minimizes your functional of interest plus a Wasserstein 2 penalization between mu and the previous iterate mu n. So this is an implicit discretization. And finally, you can also think of more complicated schemes. So for instance, if your functional g of interest is the sum of several functionals, you can think of splitting schemes that won't choose the same time discretization for each term. So for instance, I will mention the forward backward scheme, where you can choose to implement a forward time discretization for the first functional and a backward discretization for the second functional. And here, you can see that your iterate mu n plus 1 decomposes in two steps. Okay? So I will now present some motivations for this problem and Wasserstein gradient flows. Okay, so the first choice of dissimilarity that is very convenient and very popular is the choice of the relative entropy, also called the Kullback-Leibler divergence. So I just recall that the Kullback-Leibler divergence between two distributions mu and pi is defined as the integral of the log ratio of the Radon-Nikodym density of mu with respect to pi, if mu is absolutely continuous with respect to pi and is plus infinity otherwise. So if you fix pi, your distribution of interest, the one that you want to approximate, this defines a loss, g, as we've seen before. And we can compute its Wasserstein gradient. First, we compute its differential at any distribution mu. So it's a function from RD to R. And you can compute its Wasserstein gradient, which here will be simply the gradient of the log ratio mu and pi. Okay. So this is very convenient. We will see why, because this requires to know on pi gradient log pi only. So the choice of the Kullback-Leibler divergence is very popular in Bayesian statistics. Why? Because in Bayesian statistics, you have some observed labeled data. For instance, in regression, let's say, you have points wi labeled yi. You can assume an underlying model parameterized by theta, generating your data. So for instance, pi of y given w theta is Gaussian, so that you can compute the likelihood of your data set given the parameter theta. And then you assume a prior distribution on your parameter theta, which is unknown. So Bayes' rule gives you the formula for the posterior distribution of theta, so the distribution of theta given the data set, which is proportional to the likelihood times the prior distribution that you have assumed on theta. Okay, so typically here in this setting, the target distribution pi is this posterior distribution. And it's a difficult problem to be able to compute from this posterior distribution because the normalizing constant z is typically intractable. So to sample from pi, a lot of methods have been developed. In particular, there is a huge literature on Markov chain Monte Carlo methods that construct Markov chains whose law will converge to pi. But quite recently, maybe a more generic point of view was to see this task as optimizing the Kullback-Leibler divergence, right? Because you can always see pi as the minimizer of the Kullback-Leibler divergence between mu and pi. And so I'll mention it a bit after in the talk, but here it's very convenient to choose the Kullback-Leibler as a loss because we've seen that just before the Wasserstein gradient of the Kullback-Leibler only requires to be able to compute gradient log pi. And this is fine in this setting when we only know pi up to a constant, because gradient log pi does not depend on the normalization constant. It's something you have access to in this setting. Okay. So a second motivation that I will mention now is the case where you want to optimize a neural network. So for this, I need to introduce another loss, which is not an alternative to the Kullback-Leibler divergence. And this loss is known as the maximum mean discrepancy. It relies on the choice of a positive semi-definite kernel, which is a function on RD times RD to R, that basically computes the similarity between two points in RD, thanks to some embedding function into a Hilbert space. And this kernel, under appropriate assumptions, defines a distance on P2. You can compute a distance called the maximum mean discrepancy between mu and pi as the sum of three terms, which is first the integral of the kernel with respect to mu, two times, second the integral of the kernel with respect to pi, two times, and then a cross term, which is the integral of the kernel between mu and pi. So similarly, we can compute its differential of this loss here, the MMD, which will simply be a function that is the difference between the kernel integrals with respect to mu and pi, and its Wasserstein gradient under regularity assumptions. You can revert gradient and integral, and you can compute this Wasserstein gradient of the loss here, the MMD. Okay? So why is this interesting? Why is this a loss of interest? Because it corresponds to a problem which is well-known in machine learning, which is to optimize the parameters of a neural network. Indeed, think of a simple setting where you have a neural network with only one hidden layer. So here, the neurons are parameterized by some parameter z between 1 and capital N, which are here my particles. And you want to fit to regress, for instance, y on x. And so this is your labeled data. So the optimization of a neural network in this setting is typically done by minimizing the mean squared error. So you want the output of your neural net here, which is the linear combination between the output of each neuron. You want the output of the neural net, which is this guy, to match the true label y. Okay, and so this is a mean squared error, and you want to minimize this loss for the capital N best parameters on the network. So this is for a finite neural net where you have a capital N number of neurons. But now, if you let your number of neurons N go to infinity, think of this hidden layer growing to infinity, then this quantity here, the output of the neural network, can be written as an integral over the outputs of each neuron here, right, which are the phi z. And this integral is taken with respect to some distribution nu on your parameters. And now you are not minimizing on the best capital N parameters of the neural network, but on the you want to look for the best distribution nu on the parameters of your network. And you can see that these neurons are completely interchangeable, and the problem here does only depend on the distribution of the parameters. So can I just ask how much time do I have, because it's already 9:30.
Three, four minutes.
Okay, so I will go very fast. So let me explain how the previous loss writes as an MMD. So if you assume that there is an optimal distribution pi that generates your data, so that the conditional expectation of y given x actually writes as a neural network of the architecture you have chosen with some true distribution pi. In this case, you can write the previous loss that we've seen on the slide before, doing some interchange between squares and expectations. You can write this loss as the MMD between mu and pi. So here, what it says is that if you have a true distribution pi, so that you can write your data as the output of a neural net where the parameters are distributed as pi, then optimizing your neural network writes as the minimization of the MMD between mu, the current distribution over the parameters of the network, and pi, the optimal distribution. Okay, and in this case, sorry, so in this case, so let me just, yes. So yeah, here I just give an example where, for instance, we are in such a setting, a case where there exists some such distribution pi. A typical setting is a student-teacher network where pi is the distribution of the parameters of a very big neural network. And you want to approximate the output of this very big neural network called the teacher by a student network, which is much, much smaller. So it's a kind of compression. So in this case, you are exactly minimizing an MMD. And I will just, yes. So in this case, if you write the dynamics, what people do in practice is that they implement gradient descent on each parameter of the network. So everyone is aware of gradient descent. And actually, the interesting point here is that gradient descent in this setting can be seen exactly as implementing the Wasserstein gradient flow of the maximum mean discrepancy. And you have, it's the Wasserstein gradient flow, which is discretized in time. It's a forward discretization and in space because you have a finite number of neurons here, your particles. Okay, so I've given two examples in machine learning where you can optimize a functional, either, for instance, the Kullback-Leibler divergence or the maximum mean discrepancy, and different schemes are obtained from a different discretization. So since I have only 2-3 minutes, let me see what I can present. Okay, so just to mention, these two functionals are specific cases of free energies that I've presented before, where you there are specific cases in the sense that, for instance, the Kullback-Leibler divergence writes as a potential energy that drives your particles to the higher potential energy regions, plus an internal energy. And the maximum mean discrepancy writes as the sum of a potential energy and an interaction energy. So these two losses are specific cases of free energies. Okay, so I will just jump to some recent results. Let me see. All right. Yes, so with collaborators recently, we've studied, for instance, in the case of relative entropy, we studied several schemes to optimize the Kullback-Leibler divergence. We studied the forward-backward discretization, since the Kullback-Leibler can be seen as the sum of two functionals, which is the potential energy and the negative entropy. And as I've told before, you can choose to do a forward discretization for the first term and a backward discretization for the second term. And we've shown that this scheme enjoys the same rates than the proximal gradient scheme in the Euclidean setting. So even if we are in this more complicated setting of the Wasserstein space, the rates hold. And what it says is that if you have a potential V which satisfies mild assumptions of smoothness and convexity, then you can have a very fast rate for this scheme. And we show that this scheme has a much faster rate than some other schemes widely used in the machine learning literature. So how does it look like? So to implement this scheme, you need to be able to compute the backward step, which is the more difficult one because it's implicit. But here, for instance, we conducted experiments in the case where this backward step can be done in closed form. So this is the case for Gaussians, for instance. You can exactly compute this backward step. And the scheme in practice looks like this. Here we want to approximate some distribution mu star, which is a Gaussian. And we have some particles distributed as mu zero in green. And a long time from left to right, we can see that the scheme converges. And so this is in dimension one. but the rates hold in much higher dimension. Here, for instance, we have an illustration for thousands dimension. Okay, so this is one work we conducted. We also, how much time do I have? Maybe 1 minute. Should I conclude? Or... Sorry?
Okay, 1 minute.
1 minute, okay, so I will jump to the conclusion. All right. Okay, so yes, just to mention, so we have a line of work on all these schemes that can be written as Wasserstein gradient flows. Some of these schemes present convergence issues in practice that maybe are due to the time or space discretization, but you can always think of perturbing the dynamics. So this is one work we did for the case of the Wasserstein gradient flow of the MMD, where we see that adding noise to the trajectory improves a lot the convergence of the training of a neural network. So here it's the curve in red compared to other schemes. So this is one work we did. And yes, we also investigated gradient flows of other functionals that are more recent in the machine learning literature. So yes, let me jump to the conclusion. Sorry for being a bit late. So the point of this talk was to show that many problems in machine learning can be formulated as the minimization of some functional over probability distributions. So you want to approximate a target distribution pi. You can choose some dissimilarity functional, for instance, the Kullback-Leibler divergence or the maximum indiscrepancy. And you can see your sampling problem as minimizing this loss. And then many ideas from optimization can be useful in this setting, either for the discretization to study numerically or theoretically this discretization, or to propose, for instance, perturbations of the dynamics. And many open questions remain. First, in terms of numerics, you can see in our line of work, we have still many cases where these dynamics have issues in converging. For instance, when the target distribution pi is very complex, very difficult. And also in terms of theory, some optimization techniques for the theory are easily transferable in this setting, but some others are very hard to transfer from Euclidean optimization to the Wasserstein space setting. So yeah, there is still a lot of work to be done. So thank you for listening, and I'm happy to take questions.